The National Broadcasting Company brings you another in a series of general discussions by that noted woman commentator and former foreign correspondent, Dorothy Thompson. Miss Thompson.
In the midst of an enormous number of rumors, most of them unconfirmed, a few positive sources of information are at our disposal. These, they're rather dry to read, are first, the text of the British White Paper on the correspondence with the German government over Poland. Secondly, the text of Prime Minister Chamberlain's statement in the House of Commons yesterday. Third, the text of Hitler's address to the Reichstag yesterday. Fourth, a synopsis of the speech of Prime Minister Chamberlain before the House of Commons today. The British White Paper is an amazing document. It gives the entire exchange of correspondence between Mr. Chamberlain and Hitler and the texts of verbal communications made by the British ambassador in Berlin to Hitler and Hitler's replies previous to the German attack on Poland. This white paper makes it clear that the British Prime Minister from the beginning has insisted that Britain stands behind her pledge to Poland, insisted that Germany and Poland must negotiate matters between the two nations as equals, and that the British government was ready to assist in creating conditions in which such negotiations could take place, but that those conditions would necessitate a truce. Hitler, in replying, unrolled innumerable questions, including that of colonies, which he relinquished, and including pledges of his desire for the warmest friendship with England. The German communications contain numerous attacks on Poland, but never come down to an answer to the specific standpoint taken by the British government. On the contrary, Hitler's notes say that there is no room for doubt as to the fact that understanding cannot be bought at the price of any renunciation of vital German interests. In document 5, which is Hitler's reply to the second letter from Mr. Chamberlain, the German government says that it is unable to bind itself, and this is very important. It's unable to give guarantees or participate in guarantees regarding Poland without the Soviet Union being associated with those guarantees. In this same note, the German government asks the British government to see that a Polish emissary with full powers is dispatched to Poland to arrive on Wednesday. The German government, the note says, will then draw up proposals for a solution and submit these to the British government before the arrival of the Polish negotiator. The next item is a telegram from London to the British ambassador, saying that it's unreasonable to expect that the British government can produce a Polish plenipotentiary in Berlin on such short notice. This was presented to Mr. Hitler with a note from Sir Neville Henderson, British ambassador, saying that the British were advising Warsaw to avoid frontier incidents and begging the Germans to send similar instructions to Danzig. A follow-up telegram again urges Sir Neville to make it clear that the Polish government can only be expected to maintain restraint if the German government reciprocates. And in yet another telegram, sent the same day, Wednesday, the British government protests that the demand that a Polish representative come to Berlin to receive the German demand is unreasonable, the demand in the time set. This telegram asks Sir Neville to suggest to the German government that it adopt the normal diplomatic procedure and, when its proposals are ready, pass them to the Polish ambassador for transmission to Warsaw and invite suggestions for the conduct of negotiations. The British government also asks the German government to communicate the proposals to Britain. On the same night, still Wednesday, a formal reply of the British government to the German government sums up and elucidates the British government's position taken in the telegram. Now, what happened then is this, that instead of communicating the proposals to the British government, the German government released them by radio and followed that up by a note to Great Britain accusing the Poles of being unwilling to negotiate. That was on Thursday. This note, for the first time, formally presented either the British or the Poles with the 16 proposals. Telegrams of instruction from the British government to Sir Neville Henderson on Thursday say that the Polish government are taking steps to establish contact with the German government through the Polish ambassador in Berlin. And they ask, the telegrams ask, whether Dr. Karl Burkhardt, the League of Nations commissioner for Danzig, might be employed to bring about a truce in Danzig, where the Nazis, according to the British, were committing acts of sabotage. The reply to this came yesterday from the German government, and the reply was in the form of Hitler's speech, accompanied by an attack on Poland by air and from four directions on land. The last communication of Sir Neville to the British government, which was sent out very late on Thursday evening, was that the Polish ambassador was not received by Herr von Ribbentrop, the German foreign minister, until late Thursday evening, and that the Polish ambassador then, late that night, had tried to get into contact with Warsaw, but was unable to do so because all means of communication with Poland had been closed by the German government. This truly remarkable correspondence indicates that the Polish ambassador was never given even an opportunity to receive the proposals and transmit them to his government before Germany went to war. The next document that we have is Mr. Chamberlain's statement in the House of Commons yesterday, in which he summed up the contents of the white paper and made the fateful statement, quote, "In these circumstances, it appears to the government of the United Kingdom and France that by its action the German government has created conditions which call for the immediate implementation of the undertaking of Britain and France to come to the assistance of the Poles," unquote. There is another statement in this speech of Mr. Chamberlain which seems to me very important. He said, quote, "We have no quarrel with the German people except that they allowed themselves to be governed by a Nazi government. As long as that government pursues the method which it has so persistently followed within the last 2 years, there will be no peace in Europe," unquote. Now, the next thing we have is Mr. Hitler's speech, which I dealt with yesterday, and which accompanied the outbreak of the attack on Poland. Last night I dealt at length with this speech because of certain very significant passages in it, particularly near the end. I found it significant that Hitler was warning the Reichstag, that is to say, the Party Commissars, that they must take measures to prevent treason against the Nazis inside Germany. He said, quote, "Whoever believes himself able, directly or indirectly, to withstand this national command will fall. Traitors can expect nothing but death," unquote. And it is significant that the published and official text is edited. It does not conform exactly to the phonograph record of the speech. In the speech, Hitler instructed the party leaders that it was their duty to see that the morale was kept up in every district, ward, and cell of the intricate organization which covers all of Germany with what is actually a party espionage system. And he announced dramatically that he would win the Polish fight or die. Now, certain actions have also taken place. The British government last night informed the German government that it must withdraw its troops from Polish soil as a preface to negotiations or expect war. This morning, Mr. Chamberlain reported to the House of Commons that he had not received a reply to the British ultimatum. He said that he felt certain that he would be able to make a definite statement tomorrow. The Prime Minister said that the note had been presented to Herr von Ribbentrop at 9:30 last night, that Herr von Ribbentrop had replied that he must submit the communication to Hitler, and that no reply had come. Mr. Chamberlain assured the House of Commons that the delay did not indicate the slightest weakening on the part of either Britain or France. Meanwhile, we learn that another note has been sent to the German government today, but it is impossible to confirm whether or not there is a time limit set to an answer, although it would seem to be indicated by the fact that Mr. Chamberlain all but promised a definite answer when the House meets at noon tomorrow, which will be 7:30 in the morning, our time. Meanwhile, the British and French ambassadors are still in Berlin. The Polish ambassador left Berlin today with an ambiguous statement that if one liked to call it that, one could call it a severance of diplomatic relations. He added, quote, "Many accepted terms of international law go by the board these days," unquote. Now, what are the British and French governments waiting for? That's the crucial question. Are they waiting to see what Italy will do? The only word we have from Italy is an inspired statement put out on Wednesday in Rome that Signor Mussolini thinks that the whole European problem should be taken up and readjusted. We learn that the Italian Council of Ministers met yesterday, said that the origin of the German-Polish conflict lies in the Versailles Treaty, and that the Duce wishes to assure to Europe a peace based on justice and declares that Italy will take no initiative whatsoever toward military operations, which seem to indicate that Italy is neutral and that Italy has not yet abandoned the idea of a five-power conference. Furthermore, Hitler's speech indicated clearly that he renounced any Italian cooperation as far as the Polish campaign is concerned. Now, we really need somebody from the Federal Bureau of Investigation to operate on such clues as we have. But these things come out of the official statements. First, Mr. Chamberlain and Mr. Dallaglie are grateful to Mussolini. Two, Mussolini is not going to engage in military operations and still believes that there may be a general peace. Three, war action has been delayed. Four, Mr. Chamberlain has said that there can be no peace with a Nazi government unless it radically changes its policy. Five, Mr. Hitler has said he will win or die. Six, Lord Halifax and Mr. Chamberlain both declared this evening that they could not enter into a five-power parley until German troops left Poland. There's that five-power parley again that Mussolini is so keen on. And Lord Halifax said, quote, if the German government is willing to withdraw its forces, the British government will consider the position the same as it was before the German forces crossed the Polish frontier. But Mr. Hitler has said that he will not withdraw the Polish forces. I mean, he said publicly in his Reichstag speech that he will go on with what he is doing or die. And so the student of the news is led to ask, is it barely possible that something is going on in Germany that we know nothing about? Mr. Hitler's speech indicated that he's afraid of something in Germany. And this was borne out by a decree which became known last night. The German government announced that anyone listening to foreign radio broadcasts would be arrested, and anyone transmitting what he might hear on a foreign broadcast would be killed. I'd like to remind you that a few days ago, the German government suspended the mail service between the army and civilians. The army is unable to communicate with the civilian population. I do not pretend to know what all this means, but it certainly means more than meets the eye. Reports show that the German people are very apathetic. At least that's what I make out of the heavily censored broadcasts which come out of Germany. It has been reported that Hitler expected to consummate a lightning war on Poland over this weekend. And it has been stated, by no official source, but on what is called in journalese very high authority, that the German plan was to take Poland in a very quick war, a lightning war, confront the Western powers with a fait accompli, and then negotiate. But the British government demands that German troops leave Poland obviously rules out this possibility. Perhaps, of course, the whole delay concerns the position of the Italian government. But obviously the British Prime Minister thinks that it is well to play for Poland. For one reason or another, he's not going to back down, but he wants time. Meanwhile, please recall that in one of the white paper communications, Mr. Hitler said that he could make no guarantees about Poland without consulting the Soviet Union. Please recall that in yesterday's speech, Hitler paid fulsome tribute to the Soviet Union. And a military mission of six generals from Russia arrived in Berlin today. What is that military mission from the Soviets going to advise Hitler to do? Good night.
You've been listening to Dorothy Thompson, outstanding woman commentator on world affairs. Miss Thompson will be heard again tomorrow over most of these stations at 1 p.m. Eastern Daylight Saving Time.